Always want to give deference to President Trump, obviously, and yet with us right now live from Washington, D.C. is Senator Kevin Cramer. Senator, it's always great to have you with us. We appreciate you joining us live there. I think one of the things that President Trump is referring to as he's going through that conversation, he's been mentioning now throughout the press conference, is the fact that, look, we've got to get this economy back going. So I want to get your response to his tweet from earlier today. We cannot let the cure be worse than the problem itself. At the end of the 15-day period, we'll make a decision as to which way we want to go. Do you support sooner rather than later, no matter what's going on, it sounds like, with this COVID situation, getting the workers back out into the workplace?
Well, I want to say, support regardless of the outcome. I think the point of the president's tweet is that we'll see at the end of the 15 days and reassess. And I think that's appropriate. Now, Chris, clearly what he's saying, I think, anyway, when he says that, the cure might be worse than the actual disease, is maybe it's better to get everybody back to work and see what happens. But they'll have an assessment by then. We'll see how it's spreading. And I think it's a prudent approach.
Yeah, and I think also what he's saying, Senator, and correct me if I'm wrong, because I continue to hear Governor Doug Berg talking about facts, not fear. We've got 0% mortality here in the state. We've tested over 1,300 people. 30, people have tested positive, and yet I think right now it's a 1.3% mortality rate in the United States. But that's typically going to be the octogenarian, 70-year-olds, so there is maybe a possibility to get the younger people back into work. Let's go to this, Senator, because I saw your floor speech also on the Senate floor just moments ago, and I'm going to frame this way, okay? Leader McConnell said recently, the American people have had enough because you guys have now twice tried to get this bill up, pass the cloture vote to actually put a vote on the floor for this coronavirus stimulus package. Senator McConnell says the American people have had enough. They'd like to know what's going on. So I'm going to ask you, what in the double hockey sticks is going on, sir?
Well, what's going on is that Nancy Pelosi flew in on a jet yesterday morning and threw a wrench into all the deliberations. We had a bill basically done, nice 300 or so page bill, a little less than 300, I think, and then a supplemental appropriations to go along with that. Bipartisan agreement negotiated, by the way, not, and I think this is part of the problem, not between Chuck Schumer and Mitch McConnell, but between rank and file Republicans and rank and file Democrats in the United States Senate. Some things that we like, some things they like, some things we both like. And at the last minute, Nancy Pelosi flies in and says, no, I've got my own 1,200-page bill, Green New Deal, socialism for everybody. We want to carry out our vision of the world. We have this opportunity, and blew the whole thing up. And now Chuck Schumer looks like he works for her, which is not a surprise. And so they've, negotiations have gotten back on track today again. But, Chris, every time they stall for one more hour, one more day, one more half a day, they're stalling forever, because the longer negotiations are open, the more stuff they can throw in there, like fuel standards for jet airplanes and the Green New Deal, just crazy stuff.
Well, and one of the things he's put in here, and I want to get to the people that are watching, Senator, because that's what's most important to you and to me. But one of the things she's talking about is, security for elections in this bill.
Right.
I guess what I'm trying to get at here for the people that are watching is there's a lot of fear, trepidation, tension out there right now. Mm-hmm. What are you guys going to do now? Because my understanding is that because you've not completed this vote twice, you may not get anything done until Friday, Saturday, or later. What do you say to the people that are losing their jobs today, their health care today?
Well, what I can say to them is I voted yes twice, as has John Hoeven voted yes twice. Every Republican has voted yes twice. Every Democratic member has voted no twice, even after they helped shape the bill, Chris. So, if you have Democratic friends or family in other states or people in other states that have a Democratic senator and haven't fixed that problem yet, tell them to call that senator and tell them, we can't tolerate this nonsense any longer. We need help now. We needed help yesterday. We need help the day before. You dither, Americans die. Democrats dither, Americans die. They need to feel the heat.
So the Democrats out there watching that you're asking to call their senator right now is going to say, wait a second, though, this bill is not good. You guys have about $500 billion. They're dubbing it as a corporate slush fund. Secretary Mnuchin gets to pick the winners and losers. You say what to that?
Well, that's, first of all, it's a lie. It's just a lie. That's what it is. That's the first thing I can tell you. It's a lie. And what we're doing with what they call a slush fund is we're keeping the employers afloat during this major crisis. In case you haven't paid any attention, the stock market, the Dow Jones, has dropped from 30,000 to 20,000 and under 20,000. In case you weren't paying attention, price of oil went from $42 to $22. When they weren't paying attention, people are dying, people are losing their jobs, and the best way to keep people in their jobs is to provide assistance to the employers. But, Chris, we also have a lot of money in this bill for the employees. We plus up the unemployment insurance fund to add $600 per week per unemployed person. But more important than that, we provide free money to employers of 500 or fewer employees. They can take that money, pay their employees, keep them employed. Right? We have an incentive to keep people employed. Democrats are pushing an incentive to get people unemployed. Why? Because they prefer people on the getting a government check than people getting a check from a company, a restaurant, or a manufacturing firm, or an airline. So it's not true. And plus, by the way, this money that they're talking about, this $500 billion, that's where $75 billion of that is for healthcare facilities, doctors, nurses, nursing homes, clinics, small clinics, big clinics, small hospitals, big hospitals. The other $425 billion, Chris, is for the Treasury Department to invest into what's called the Exchange or Economic Stabilization Fund at the Federal Reserve. That $425 billion turns into $3 trillion. First of all, none of it can be lent. None of it can be granted. It has to be paid back. It's all loans. Second of all, none of it can be used to increase the salary of corporate executives. Thirdly, none of it can be used to buy back stocks. It's to create jobs. They have to demonstrate that they keep the same number of employees working for them. This is a shock to the markets, Chris.
And I want to get more down to the personal level here. But to be fair, sir, according to what we see is that the Treasury Secretary would have discretion over where that $500 billion fund goes.
Well, who else would? Who else would decide that? We're going to pick and choose which corporations I like or you like, or, you know, of course.
I mean, that's what happened with the Wall Street bailout. You guys were bailing out Wall Street before and picking, you know, winners and losers. So I'm just saying that I think that's where you're going to see some trepidation. People going, look, we bailed out Wall Street.
We can let them all fail. We can let them all fail, Chris. We can just let the entire economy just fall apart. But I don't think that's what North Dakotans want.
I really don't. But so let's get to this, Senator, because a couple weeks ago we had you on. This was March 10th. I want to play for you a little clip. We were talking about the economy. One of the things that you said, and then just give you a chance to respond to kind of what the conversation is today, because to be fair, things are moving very fast. Here's you back on March 10th, I believe.
What this economy wants isn't more stimulus. What this economy wants is for the coronavirus to be fixed.
So there you're saying, hey, we don't want more stimulus. We need to fix this thing. So should we just not worry about the stimulus and just shut everything down? As Steve Bannon is saying, look, we need to clamp this thing down, punch this thing in the face, if you will, and then figure it out in 2 weeks.
Well, when Steve Bannon becomes a health professional, then we'll take his advice on that. There may be something to that, and I think that's what the president wants to reconsider at the end of the 15 days, whether that's the right move or not. But we do have two issues here. We do want to keep the virus under control and eventually kill it. But what we're talking about now isn't about a stimulus, Chris. We're talking about keeping people employed, paying their rent, paying their mortgage, buying their groceries. $350 billion goes directly to small employers to keep people employed. This is not a stimulus by any stretch. Now, I would say the $425 billion that the Federal Reserve can put into existing widely available credit facilities, that's things that they already do. The liquidity that you often hear about, that will help the stock markets at the very least maintain. We're not going to see a soaring in the market until the coronavirus is fixed. I don't think there's any question. The market needs certainty well into the future. But in the meantime, we don't want to be in a hole that they can't dig out of either. So it's really, you know, more of a safety net than it is a stimulus.
Let's go back to what you said here in a moment. But I do, again, want to keep this focus on the people at home. And quickly, sir, so we've talked about direct payments. The Democrats are saying, hey, look, we don't have any means test. You guys want means test. Is there going to be direct payments, assuming something gets passed, and is it going to be just one payment of that $1,200, or is it going to be two payments, indefinite payments? What's it going to be?
So the direct payment piece that you're talking about will go to everybody that makes less than, I think Democrats have wanted it higher than the $150,000. I think it might be $180,000 or $190,000. I don't remember exactly. But it's $1,200 per adult. So if it's a married couple in a household that files jointly and they make under a certain amount, then they would get $2,400, and then for each child another $500. That goes to every household, regardless
just
of
once or
whether you lose your job or don't
monthly.
Lose your job.
Just once, sir, or would that be monthly?
Well, the bill, the last draft that we had of it was just one time up front, in the first week of April. And then if necessary, in 3 months or so, we can do it again. But that's not in the first part of the bill.
And I think the challenge, Senator, as you know better than I do, is can people get to April 6th at this point? So that obviously
That's why the other piece is so critical, Chris,
right,
where they get paid by their employer. If their employer is less than 500 people, that employer can borrow $10 million, 100% federally secured, no collateral, and they get the money, and they get to, the loan is forgiven as long as they're using it to pay the salaries.
And
they can pay fixed costs like utilities and rent and things like that.
And that could hit their bank accounts within 24 hours, 48
Very
hours?
Very fast. Probably not within 24 hours because they have to go to their bank. We're bypassing the federal government. It's a federal program, but we're bypassing the SBA, even though they're sort of the backstop. But it's going right to banks. So what you want to do is have a good relationship with your local bank. And, it wouldn't be in anticipation of
right.
it, Chris, it wouldn't be a bad idea to start that problem.
Senator, I got to ask you this because Nancy Pelosi came out and spoke about this. It was 10 years ago today that President Barack Obama signed on to the Affordable Care Act. Many people I talk to as well are very concerned because now they're losing their health care. They may have COBRA, but we all know how expensive that is. Does the bill that you guys are putting together, will that guarantee health coverage for people as they go through this time?
It does, Chris. It provides $75 billion direct cash infusion. Now, it also includes increased Medicaid, increased Medicare reimbursement. One of the unfortunate things and the challenges we're having as I talk to administrators around North Dakota and around the country, for that matter, is that because they're not able to do elective surgeries, that's where they make their money. They're already thin margins are even thinner, and that's particularly difficult for rural hospitals. So all of this would apply no matter what the size. Even the smallest rural hospital would have access to some of this money, and would stay very close in touch with them. Obviously, we need to keep them open. We don't want to create an opportunity for big consolidations or purchases. That stuff happens bad. It happens often enough without this in addition. So we've got several vehicles for the healthcare sector. But we have to pass the bill, Democrats. We have to pass the bill.
Senator,
so Minnesota's got two Democratic senators, Minnesotans. Call them. Tell them to pass the bill now.
Thank you. In fact, producer Anna, if we can get the phone number for the end of the show, let's make sure we've got that so people can call the Senate phone board and start to ping those people and let them know. One last thing, Senator, I want to get your take on, since you're on the Senate Armed Services Committee, maybe you can help explain this for a layman like myself.
Sure.
But President Trump now has said, look, I am a wartime president. What does that mean to a layman like myself? And are there some states right now that you would consider to be under martial law?
Well, it's interesting. I think he's handled it quite well in terms of the martial law question, in that he's leaving it up to governors to make the determination of how much to flex, how much to mandate. Certainly big concentrated states like New York, that makes more sense than it probably does in some states. I think Governor Burgum's done an excellent job of managing that just right for both our culture and, the sort of the geography and whatnot of our state. So I think he's handled that pretty well. In terms of the wartime footing, I think what he's referencing there is it's an all of government, all of society approach, that we're prepared to do whatever is necessary, which he has done. He's got manufacturers that are changing their manufacturing lines, of course, to meet the demands, the healthcare demands, particularly ventilators, as we know, with the auto dealers or auto manufacturers. And so it's things like that. Whether or not he goes further, I think that's going to be part of the 15-day assessment, Chris. But I think to this point, he's handled it quite well.
Senator Kevin Cramer, I could talk to you for a lot longer. I know, the recent news about Senator Rand Paul, so we're just going to ask you to stay safe, sir. Take care of your health, and we look forward to having you back on soon, okay?
All right. Thank you, Chris.
Thank you very much.